Hey guys, breaking news. Thanks to Fancy Fiction, I found out that Harvey Adelson got sued in federal court back in February. So let's take a quick look at the complaint here. This doesn't have much to do with the Dan Markell case, but I figured it might be of interest. So the plaintiff is Danny Tejero, and he is suing Harvey's corporation, as well as him individually, alleging violations of the Fair Labor Standards Act. So he says he lives in Dade County, Florida, and that he alleges that he worked as a maintenance person for Harvey and the company for a number of years. So he wants overtime, liquidated damages, costs, and reasonable attorney's fees pursuant to federal law. Says he worked more than 40 hours a week. And this is where it sounds a little strange to me, that he alleges the corporation was engaged in commerce or production of goods for commerce by regularly and recurrently using the instrumentalities of interstate commerce to accept and solicit funds from non-Florida sources, by using electronic devices to authorize credit card transactions, by ordering products and supplies produced out of state. So, not being a specialist in this, it does sound kind of bizarre. So why is this in federal court? I do think that Florida should have its own state laws regarding wages. So it's kind of interesting why this wasn't also a state case. So he's claiming that the corporation made more than $500K per year. So there is enterprise coverage. Okay, so this whole interstate commerce allegation sounds a little strange, okay, because he's a maintenance guy for a property located in Florida. So he's saying he worked with goods and materials moved in interstate commerce. Okay, so this guy, Danny Tejero, says he was working from October 15th, 2008 to June 15th, 2002, or more than 13 years. So for this case, his relevant employment period is 74 weeks, okay, because I'm assuming there could have been a statute of limitations issues. Okay, so he says he was a handyman. He had multiple responsibilities: maintenance, emergency repairs, plumbing, electricity, painting, etc. He was paid a salary of $900 a week. He says he worked 5 days a week, Monday through Friday, 8 to 6 p.m. After 6, he was permanently on call. He attended emergency calls for at least 10 more hours. Wow, that seems excessive. He completed 60 working hours in a week. He didn't take bona fide lunchtime. He worked more than 40 hours a week, but did not get overtime. He didn't clock in and out. Okay, so this allegation is important because he's claiming that Harvey and the company had absolute control over his schedule and activities, because otherwise, as I'm sure Harvey's attorney would argue, is that this guy was really an independent contractor, that he was the one that was able to control his hours, provided his own tools, his own place of work, that he had total flexibility. So I'm sure that could be a big issue, whether this guy was really an employee versus independent contractor. So this is also another kind of interesting point. It says he was paid in cash without pay stubs, showing info about the actual number of days worked, wage, rate paid, employee taxes withheld, etc. So I doubt taxes were withheld, but the question is, how is he supposed to prove this case if he just got cash? He was happy back then. There's no documentation about his so-called real work or work hours. So he's claiming that Harvey fired him around June 15th, 2022, and alleges that Harvey Adelson was and is the owner, manager, partner of 7th Street Apartment. Okay, so this is all a bunch of required legal language. Okay, collective action. This is also a little weird because you would think if he had other potential plaintiffs, he would have found them by now. So he wants this to cover every maintenance employee, and any similarly situated individuals who worked for defendants during the last 3 years. Okay, so these are the different counts: wage and hour, failure to pay overtime. Okay, so I'm curious, what are the details? Like, was he actually working on site, or was he just, you know, doing different types of assignments, not stuck at Harvey's property during this time? So, okay, so this is sort of repetitive. They say defendants didn't even post the labor laws. He doesn't even have time and payment records, but he will provide a reasonable good faith estimate based on his recollections and to the best of his knowledge. Then he's going to amend his claim later. Okay, so that just sounds kind of weak, because he's claiming he worked there for 13 years, although he's limiting this to more recent time periods. But how's he supposed to do a good faith estimate? Does he have like his own day planner or calendars or what? So this is his calculation. He claims he should have gotten $11,100. Okay, so he's alleging that Harvey knew, showed reckless disregard of the Fair Labor Standards Act. So he's entitled to get double damages plus attorney's fees pursuant to law. And his attorney is Xandro Palma. Now I'll show you his website. He's an attorney in Florida, Miami, called the Palma Law Group. Okay. So let's see his. He has a really good website. Okay. So doesn't he sort of looks like Dan Markell. Interesting. But great website. He's going to fight for people. He does cases on a contingency basis, free consultations. I checked out his LinkedIn. And he graduated from, let's see, St. Thomas Law School for his JD. And he got a master's from University of Miami. So this is his nice looking website, thepalmalawgroup.com. Okay, so let's take a look at, here, remove that, technical issues here. So instead of filing an answer, Harvey's attorney decided to go ahead and file a motion to dismiss. So that's something that is totally common, where the defendant claims that even on its face, the lawsuit is totally deficient, so it should be just dismissed. Okay, so Harvey's attorney is his longtime friend, Gary Cohen, who was the person who had offered Wendy a job if she moved down to Southern Florida. And this person appears to be very supportive of Harvey and the family. I don't know how they knew each other, but seems like they have been very, very close friends. So maybe his friend is doing this pro bono. Okay, so this is a well-drafted motion. You can see for yourself, lack of subject matter jurisdiction, failure to state a claim. Okay, so he's saying that the plaintiff didn't specify the time period or approximate number of hours worked during the given period whereby overtime is allegedly owed. He didn't sufficiently plead allegations to establish that his alleged employment is covered by the Fair Labor Standards Act, such that Harvey was an employer, or that they were engaged in interstate commerce to qualify for relief. Yeah, and then talk about how that similarly situated part is flimsy. They don't have the required components for the Fair Labor Standards Act to apply. So the court lacks subject matter jurisdiction. So the complaint is legally insufficient, fails to state a cause of action. Okay, so this is the legal standard, Civil Procedure Rule 12b-6. Okay, hopefully this is readable, because I'm sure nobody wants to hear me trying to read this whole thing. So, okay, legal analysis, this is good. Okay, he didn't give enough specific details about the hours he worked. It's just an arbitrary time period of 74 weeks. He never clocked in or clocked out. He was paid with cash without pay stubs. So the allegations are internally inconsistent. So the complaint should be dismissed. Okay, so this makes sense to me. Plaintiff is claiming that Harvey could track the number of days and hours he worked, but then he also concedes to having never clocked in and out of work or received pay stubs about that. Okay, if true, this lawsuit has been filed frivolously, as plaintiffs have no evidence to support their claims for overtime pay. Okay, so this time, I think this is a good argument here that neither the, quote, employee or employer was engaged in interstate commerce. Okay. So this is where, I recall, I think this is where they're saying that he wasn't even a real employee and they were not engaged in commerce. Okay, so this is a good recitation of the law. So they're saying that his duties confirm his role as maintenance worker was confined to a local property located in Broward County, Florida. Okay, so it doesn't relate to movement of commerce. And they also deny that Harvey was an employer enterprise engaged in commerce or engaged in interstate commerce as defined by the statute. Okay. So they want to dismiss the lawsuit without any further proceedings. Okay, how many pages is this? Let's see, not sure. Okay, lack of subject matter jurisdiction. He failed to meet the requirements of a Fair Labor Standards Act claim. Okay, so again, they're quoting the requirements. That act specifically does not cover independent contractors. So you have to look at the economic reality of the relationship between the alleged employee and employer. Okay, so they're saying that Danny Tejero ultimately controlled his own schedule, how and when he completed assignments, and whether he would take on more or less of them, showing that he was essentially in business for himself. Okay, he didn't have to clock in or out. He was paid in cash. Payment had no pay stubs. Okay, so it sounds like nobody had accurate time records. Okay, and they also claim that Mr. Tejero never did any work for FL2518LLC. He worked at a different location and a different LLC. Okay, so this sounds pretty good, pretty convincing to me. But of course, I don't know the whole facts of the case, but I'm kind of leaning towards Team Harvey's defense in this situation. Okay, so I'll take this off the screen. So then there was a motion to give the plaintiff's attorney more time to respond. And as of yesterday, I didn't see any sort of court order on this. So he was just saying he was too busy with depots, mediations, settlement conferences, hearings. So he needs more time to file a response, which was, I think, due on April 3rd. So I don't see anything filed since then. Okay, other than, see here, this is a scheduling order, which is required in federal court cases. And let me drink some water here. Okay, joint scheduling report. Well, they couldn't even come to an agreement here. So parties are not in agreement with proposed dates. So plaintiff wants it under the standard track, Harvey's attorney, and he wants his case to be under the expedited track. So they're going to send it to the court in Word format and leave it up to Judge Rosenberg to fill in the blanks. Okay. So different deadlines for completing discovery. Discovery would be produced in PDF format. Okay. So they don't know about the likelihood of settlement at this time. They don't anticipate appearance of additional parties. So that's weird because he seemed to want to make it a collective action. Okay, so nothing totally mind-blowing here. Just scroll through in case people want to pause the video and read every single word. Okay, so if there is a trial, they think it would take 2 to 3 days. Okay, so let's see when the plaintiff's attorney is going to file his response to the motion to dismiss. Okay, let me take this off the screen. All right, so that's the news for today. I did do a little bit of searching on the plaintiff, and looks like just last year he had filed a different lawsuit back in May 2023 against Natland Management Investments. So that, again, was a proposed class action with Fair Labor Standards Act claims. And that case probably settled pretty quickly because there was a dismissal filed back in July of last year. So looks like this guy either has lots of bad luck with employers, or maybe he's a little lawsuit happy. There's also a lawsuit that someone with the same name had filed against an insurance company a few years ago, but I don't think that was in federal court, or I couldn't find that info. So there's the news. Thanks for bearing with me with my terrible voice. I do have another medical appointment coming up next week, and hope you appreciate this dress. If you guys can identify it, that's great. Have a wonderful weekend. Thank you.